wonderful 4th of July so far. God is good. And we want to thank Him all the time and all the time.
God is good.
These choir folks got it down. But this is a very special day, and we welcome each of you. We've got family, a whole pile of family here with the Heslips. Little ones and big ones. God bless y'all. We're glad y'all are with us today. As we get started this morning, we do want to go to the Lord in the time of prayer, time of prayer request. If we have prayer requests this morning. Yes,
daughter spoke, Joan's sister.
Okay, Joan's sister. Mm-hmm.
What was her name again?
Doris Pope.
Yes, Phil.
J.B. Dean, my father.
Okay.
He's in the home of Porter Wright. Just needs a little bit of prayer.
Okay. Thank you, Phil.
John.
Yes.
The way in this morning at the fire station, it was prayers for the Taylor family. I don't know anything about the Taylors, but I saw that up.
Okay. Prayers for the Taylor family.
Taylor family. Yeah.
Okay. I had one of my former church members on our prayer list, Charles Johnson. He passed away. We want to remember his family in our prayers. Anyone else?
Just keep the Adams family in your prayers.
Adams family. Anyone else? Don't forget our announcements wise. We do want to remember the service celebration for Rusty coming up on the 17th. Here at the church, 10 to 11, a time of just fellowship together. Service will start at 11, followed by dinner on the grounds with potluck. So just make your plans to be a part of that and show your love and support Diane and your fond memories of Rusty. Anyone else? She did not like that banana.
It's so, to have kids.
Amen. Someone else? Well, let's go to the Lord in this time of prayer, man. Ask Him to bless us as we meet together this morning. Father, we come to you thanking you for this day, for this 4th of July, for our nation, for our founding fathers, for the way that you make yourself known every day, and sometimes in just very simple little ways, but all we have to do is open our eyes and heart and see you at work. We thank you for so we ask now that you would move in this time today as we sing. May it be pleasant to your ears. As we pray, may we communicate and listen to you as you speak to us. And as we break the bread of life this morning, may you just be with us. May we hear. Take the words into our heart, but not just keep them there, but live them out in our life. We thank you for all this now. Be with each of the requests that lifted up this morning. We just thank you for being the great I Am. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. You would take your hymnal, turn to page 644, so I'll stand to sing the national anthem. 646.
about the Robert Schuller of the Crystal Cathedral. I'm talking about fighting Bob Schuller. He was an evangelist, a radio personality, and this man said this. He said, "I love this land of my nativity. I loyally support this land of my nativity. I cannot be glad or grateful for many trends of our times, the vice, the crime, the mark, the trail of modern political liberalism are not to my liking. I cannot be grateful that the Supreme Court made itself a legislative rather than an interpreted body of mine. America has swept disastrously from her moorings. Her great labor movements are now afflicted with racketeerism. Her statements have degenerated until many pygmies sit where giants used to be. She is not the America of Washington, of Lincoln, of Teddy Roosevelt, or other giants of the days that are behind us. A deadly national apostasy has swept over the land, but with all her faults, which I humbly confess, she is the best country on earth. She is God's great frontier of liberty and God's last stand in the eternal battle for human freedom." And Dr. Lee says this, "Had we more citizens with his love for and loyalty to our land, it would never be in danger of becoming a land of the spree and home of the rave instead of the land of the free and the home of the brave." Wow. Interesting notes there. You know, we think about that and we find that today in America, 20 of the largest cities have a violent crime rate up 28% from 2020. And we find that these cities who say that they need to defund law enforcement, it's up 68%. Nonviolent crime is up in many cities, but down in most of the cities because police just will not make arrests now. 1 in 5 churches may close in 2021. First time in history that less than 50% of the nation says they go to church. So we look at all that and then we find a man by the name of Lawrence Gould, who was the president emeritus of Carleton College, he wrote this, "I do not believe the greatest threat to our future is from bombs and guided missiles. I don't think our civilization will die that way. I think it'll die when we no longer care." Arnold Toynbee pointed out that 19 of 21 great civilizations in history have died from within and not by conquest from without. There were no bands playing and flags waving when these civilizations decayed. It happened slowly, in the quiet of the dark. No one was aware. The heart of man is the place the devil dwells. I feel sometimes that he even dwells in me. We look at all this and we see something. Now keep in mind, the first gentleman I quoted, he was an evangelist and radio personality in the 30s and the 40s. Keep that in mind. All the quotes I just made were at least 40 years old. Wow. We say, things are awful, things are bad. And yes, they are, but you know, there is a one-word answer to all of America's problems today. One word. metanoia. That is Greek, metanoia, and it means repentance. We don't hear much today about repentance. Repentance is not something that we want to talk about unless we're talking about someone we don't like. You, well, you need to repent. You know, I'm okay, but boy, you've got problems. You know, we don't hear anything about repentance. Sort of like, you know, repentance shouldn't be like the man who wrote a $150 check to the IRS and he sent a note with it, said, "If I cannot sleep, I'll send you the rest of what I owe." That's not repentance. It's been said that our nation would be a better place if our public officials would talk less and say more. Repentance without belief is remorse, and remorse will lead to guilt, and that guilt you'll carry around until everyone is in a mental facility. We need repentance in our land. Paul Tournay said, "True freedom is not found without confession of our sins and the experience of divine forgiveness." So we say all that to go to God's Word, and we look and we find a simple passage of Scripture that Jesus gives us, and it's in Mark chapter 1, and we look at verse 16, well, actually 14 and 15, my glasses are fogging up here. Verses 14 and 15, I'd like for you, if you would, to stand as we honor the reading of God's Word. Mark chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. Mark writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and he says this, "Now, after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" You may be seated. Jesus picks up the message that John the Baptist started. John the Baptist said, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." And now the very first message that Jesus preaches is, "The time is at hand. Repent." Repent. Repent. Now, unfortunately, most of the Jews, they would hear these words and they would take them as political commentary that the kingdom of God was at hand. In other words, that the kingdom of Rome was about to be done away with because their political Messiah had arrived on the scene. But we know that's not what Jesus was talking about. Jesus was talking about metanoia. Metanoia is a frequent word that's used in the New Testament. The noun form occurs 24 times, while the verb appears 34 times. And we see, obviously, the word indicates something very powerful. Any words that are used that much in Scripture, when you hear something repeated over and over and over and over and over again, you need to be paying attention. Metanoia. Metanoia means a change of mind. Meta means a change. Noia means of mind. So it's talking about a change in your life. Repentance simply is a change that you make. Your you're walking towards sin, you're going in the wrong direction, and you turn your back on that, and you're going toward God. That is repentance, and that is what we are talking about, is Jesus proclaiming here. So let's look at this, and let's understand, we need repentance. You and I need to be men and women who are godly, walking with Him daily, and being faithful to Him. So let's look at this and see the motivation. Why should we be motivated to repentance? Why should our land be motivated to repentance? That's sort of obvious. You know, years ago there was a show on television I really liked. A lot of people liked the Addams Family, but I was one who liked the Munsters. Anybody remember the Munsters? All right, come on, be honest. All right, the Munsters had some really cool people on it. Fred Gwynne, of Car 54 fame, he was in it. He was Herman Munster. Then he had a wife named Lily, and he had a son named Eddie. Now, Herman was like Frankenstein's monster, and Lily was sort of, I don't know exactly what you would consider her, but anyway, she wasn't just your average, everyday person either. Eddie was a little small werewolf type guy. Grandpa was a vampire. And so Grandpa, by the way, was Lily's father, not Herman's. Herman didn't claim him as his father. But Eddie comes home from school one day. And honestly, Eddie was just all upset. And so he comes home, and his dad sits him down and says, "What's the matter?" Eddie said, all the kids at school are making fun of my pointed ears and my long teeth. I don't like who I am. I don't like to be made fun of." And Herman says, "Eddie, the lesson I want you to learn is it doesn't matter what you look like. Doesn't matter if you're tall or short, fat or thin, or handsome like your father or ugly like your grandpa. Doesn't matter what you look like. What does matter is the size of your heart and the strength of your character." A direct quote from Herman Munster in 1965. Folks, isn't that the truth? I mean, we think about it. So we see that we should be motivated to metanoia because of it's that profound sense of sorrow when we realize that our thoughts and our actions are hurtful to others and hurtful to ourselves and contrary to what God wants for us. You know, you have to understand that sorrow in and of itself, that is not repentance, folks. It is not repentance. Worked in law enforcement for several years. And you know, I'd make an arrest, bring the person to jail, get them booked in, and they'd be in the little holding cell, and it'd be just a crying, just squalling. And I'm thinking, man, that person is really, really ashamed of what they've done. And then when you get to talking to them, they're not ashamed of what they've done, they're ashamed they got caught. Folks, sorrow in and of itself is an emotion that can lead to repentance, not necessarily does. The Bible tells us that Judas repented when he saw Jesus condemned to die. The word used there is not metanoia, but metanoloamai, which means a great sorrow. He actually was sorrowful, but he didn't repent. So we look and we see we must recover a sense of sorrow over the tragic consequences of sin, not a sorrow for having been caught. This nation needs to recover a godly sense of sorrow for where we are. This nation needs to be a lot different than that guy in jail. We need a turning from the direction we're headed in and turning back to the Lord God Almighty. Vance Havner once told a small boy getting caught stealing peaches from a neighbor's orchard. He once told him that, and he lectured him, and he said, asked the little boy then, "Well, son, what did you learn from what I've taught you?" He said, "Well, I learned that I might not know what them peaches were sprayed with." So not stealing was wrong, but he might eat that peach and it might kill him because it'd been sprayed with pesticide. See, that's where we are today. We no longer have a sorrow for committing the sin. We have a sorrow because of what happens. So we need to have that motivation, that deep sorrow that we understand it's hurtful. We understand that we're hurting others every day. And then there has to be not only that deep sorrow, that motivation, but there's got to be a conscious act. The second dimension of metanoia is not just the first is sorrow, but the second one is this, a conscious act of turning away from a lifestyle because one has experienced a change of mind. An open, receptive mind is a necessary, critical factor in true repentance. Now, we look and we see that, you know, new truth must have access to our mind. Now, that means that you and I need to keep an open mind and listen and know when God and His Word tells us something is sin. Guess what? It's sin. There's no if, there's no maybe, there's no but, there's no, well, you don't know what it's like. I don't have to know what it's like. God does, because He knows everything. And if He says something's wrong, it is wrong. Significantly, Jesus found a greater reception for preaching in Galilee than He did in Judea. In Galilee, minds were open and receptive, whereas in Judea, the religious mindset, the dogmatic minds were closed to the truth of God in Jesus Christ. They were under the thumb of the religious leaders. They were under the thumb of the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees. And as a result, Jesus could not do the works in Judea that He did in Galilee. So we see metanoia, it's not just a once and for all deed, but it's a lifestyle of openness to God's Spirit in your life. So you have the motivation, which is great sorrow. You have that conscious act of turning, but then you also have the direction, because folks, repentance requires sorrow. It requires a conscious act of turning, but it doesn't stop there. You remember Jesus was telling about a person who had a demon cast out. And that person, he pictured it as the house being swept clean. But the person put nothing back in. And what happened? The demon that was cast out got a bunch of his buddies and said, "Ooh, this is a good place right here. Let's go back." Why? Because sorrow and an act was committed, but there wasn't a direction afterwards. Folks, God works when we act and move toward Him. When Jesus said, "Draw nigh unto me, I'll draw nigh unto you." You look and you see here that Jesus said to repent. And what did He say after repent? And believe in the gospel. So repentance, that conscious act, that sorrow, that conscious act for your sins, and that act of turning from your sins. But then you've got to do something there, which is believe in the gospel. America needs Jesus. Period. Again, it's like we've got so many politicians now that talk. Listen to some of them. It's interesting. Anytime you hear one interviewed, they'll be asked a question, and man, they'll talk for 10, 15 minutes. A simple yes or no answer, but they go all around it, and guess what? They talk, but they never say anything. We've got to have a new direction. Jesus said to believe the gospel. Our emphasis many times on repentance deals exclusively with excising sin from our lives without emphasis on that new direction. We want to get the sin out, but we don't want to get the Savior in. Jesus told the parable of that man. He is cleansed from that evil spirit. And the evil spirit, he returned, had seven others. He came back in. And we look at that, and that is a prime example of America today. Nature hates a vacuum. The emptiness of a person will become filled with something. Jesus said, repent and believe the gospel. Believing in the gospel is the commitment of one's life to the good news of God in Christ Jesus. So, true repentance moves beyond our sorrow for our sin, and it moves to a purposeful decision to love God with one's whole heart and love our neighbor as ourselves. So, today, America is celebrating a birthday. But you know what? We may not have many more unless America reaches a point to where there is metanoia in its life. You say, "Well, preacher, I can't do anything about America." what's interesting, you look at Jesus starting with 12 disciples. By the end of Acts, the gospel had spread to the entire world. Say, I can't make a difference. You can make a difference. Start by making a difference in your own life. And that light then that shines out from you will shine on others. And others will come to know Jesus this morning. I don't want to sound like a prophet of doom and gloom, because I am not. We live in the greatest nation that has ever been placed on this planet. But we live in a sinful nation, a nation that needs to repent. Revival starts with one person turning their life over to the Lord, completely, wholly, repenting, following Him. It's been said that the world has never seen what can happen through the life of one righteous person. This morning, would you be that person? Question today is this: all of us can gripe, we can complain, we can just get bitter, we can, you know, not like our fellow man, we can do all kinds of stuff and be miserable, or we can follow Jesus and be happy. Because following Jesus, the joy that comes from that doesn't have anything to do with what anybody else is doing. Honestly, like last night, the night before, and it'll be that way tonight. Folks, this preacher likes to go to bed early. But I'm going to tell you something. 4th of July weekend, that don't happen. Ever told me last night, said, why are you going to bed now? You know it's going to get worse. But you know what? I went to bed. I went on to sleep. I didn't like all the bomb blasts. Somebody was shooting a cannon or something just right there. I mean, it was like, shook the house. My one cat that don't wake up for anything even jumped up. No, I didn't much care for that, but you know what? That's fine. Folks were having a good time. That's fine. We are a nation. One nation under God. If we would truly put that in here, every person, we'd see a whole different world. Let's pray. Father, we come to you now, and we just ask that you would speak to our hearts this morning. We know that you are at work. We know that you are God. You are